Olha, David, olha isso. Remember, the first thing that we covered, it was, let's call this one vacuum slash air, okay? Vacuum and air, it is represented by epsilon zero and mu zero. Or we can consider epsilon r is equal to one and mu r is equal to one. Okay, so this is vacuum. And with mu r equal to one, this means that we are dealing with a non-magnetic region. Non-magnetic region. And then the next step, the next medium that we consider, the lossless medium. And in lossless medium, these are defined as conductivity equal to zero, okay? But the ER, the relative permittivity, it can be higher than one. Okay, so we just want to indicate that something is different with regard to the wave propagation, and this one is reflected in several important parameters. Now, one thing which is very essential in vacuum and in air, which you are going to remember, is the relation between the magnitude of the electric field and the magnitude of the magnetic field. So this EM waves, we have the E and H, okay, they are related as the magnitude of H here, it's equal to the magnitude of E divided by the intrinsic impedance, okay? And this intrinsic impedance in vacuum, this is equal to the magnitude of E over 120 pi, okay? And now, when we have a lossless medium, which has no conductivity, but it has an ER, relative permittivity, higher than one, then we know that this intrinsic impedance, which is expressed as the square root of mu over epsilon, okay, this is going to be the mu R over ER times mu zero over E zero, okay, so this is how we find the ratio between the E and the H. And then here, depending on these values, this will be different, but let's assume for a moment that we are dealing with non-magnetic medium. Non-magnetic medium is when mu r is 1, so it's not magnetic, and then we can simply, or often, we might see these values times 120 pi. So, please keep this in the formula sheet or in the cheat sheet that we are going to use when we solve different problems. So, last time we discussed these types of problem. Now we are going to analyze lossy medium. Lossy medium is when the conductivity is different from zero. Okay. So now we are dealing with a new set of problems where we have some conductivity, and we know that whenever we have an external electric field, okay, let's assume that we have an external electric field, what happens if we have some conductivity? The material, it has, let's say, let's assume for a moment that it's going to be polarized, okay, and the polarization is the response of a material against an external electric field. And imagine for a moment that this electric field it has a certain frequency, okay? And the frequency, it means that the rate of change as a function of time. Now, you can think, for example, what is the frequency of communication in general, or what is the common frequency of the E field, of the electric field? You can always, one thing that you should never forget is that you're gigahertz. Okay, gigahertz is a common magnitude of frequencies which we use it a lot. And for example, we have, as we said the last time, we used to have cell phone communication at 800 to 900 megahertz. Now we have been using for almost a decade, the 3G. Now we are almost at 4G. Cell phones, if you have a fast internet connection with a good data plan, you get a 4G for a few gigabytes, and then they downgrade it to 3G for the rest of the gigabytes because it costs now we're going to 5G. So we're talking about something like gigahertz, which is around 10 to the power 9. So this is the frequency. Now, imagine for a moment that this 10 to the power 9 gigahertz is going to affect a material which is composed of dipoles. Okay, let's think for a moment what is going to happen in these dipoles. If we have an incoming wave and the electric field is approaching in such a way, then this is going to happen. So the time, we know that this time scale, okay, of course it's going to be twice, or let's say a factor of twice. So the complete wave actually is going to be something like this. Let's draw this correctly. So the time scale is the first thing that an engineer should start thinking. Okay, so this incoming wave, this 3G that I have in the cell phones, what I'm talking about are things changing in the order of second, in the order of millisecond, in the order of microsecond, nanosecond. That's what we should consider. So anything which is around 3 gigahertz, something like, what is giga? 10 to the power 9. So we're talking about nanosecond. Okay? Nanosecond. And nanosecond, it is easy for an electromagnetic wave to repeat itself in a few nanoseconds. But it's not the same for a dipole, which is composed of charges inside the material. Imagine that when the wave is approaching, this dipole might have a tendency now to oscillate, okay, or to respond to the external excitation. So then this will respond. But think for a moment, this has a mass, okay? Photons, it's easy for photons to play around at different frequencies, but once you are dealing with something that has a mass, the response is much slower, which means that if we have an external electric field, we're going to have a polarization vector, but this polarization vector, it is not in phase. Nuk është në fazë në fushën e jashtë të elektrike. Kjo do vënohet polarizimi. So the generation or the change of polarization in time is going to delay a little bit, and this will create a phase difference. Okay? So this, let me write this one, this will be delayed. Okay? And this implies a phase difference. Phase difference. Now, how do we represent the phase difference in when we use the phasor notation? The phase difference, in general, we might expect the following. Let's say, for example, we have E0 or E1. This is the first one electric field. This would be the amplitude of E1 times Ay, the magnitude, times e to the power minus kz. And the phase difference in the, sorry, we need a j here. We need a j, a complex number, in order to represent an oscillatory wave. If we don't have this j, we know what is going to happen. It's going to exponentially decrease. Let's keep this for a moment. So let's write this one. This is an oscillatory behavior, which means that the electric field, it will keep repeating itself at a good, preserving the magnitude of the wave. Now, imagine for a moment, this is E2. It can be E2 times Ay, the direction of the electric field, or also, which is also the polarization of the wave. This is going to be, just for the sake of the argument that we started discussing before a moment, this is exponentially decreasing. And an exponentially decreasing function, it decreases very fast, which means that this amplitude, it will be attenuated. But let's keep this for a moment like this. Now, we were actually talking before we came to this argument, whether you should see a J here or not. And with a J, in many textbooks, you can find this J. You can find it also as I. Or, but we know that it's the square root of minus 1, which is a mathematical construct, and it's strange because we use this term mathematical construct so often, and with this we just want to say, we just want to clarify that it's not something very realistic, okay? That's why I call it a mathematical construct, because we have something which is not defined, we define it in such a way, and we find thousands of applications everywhere. Now, so please don't forget to have this square root of minus 1 appearing here. okay? Because it will represent an oscillating function. Let's come back again. Node J, exponentially decreasing. Let's write here the other aspect, how we're going to represent this phase difference in here. This is going to be something like E3 AUI, the polarization this way. This is going to be e to the power minus jkz plus phi, okay? So this thing is going to appear into the propagator, okay, into this term. Now, we made some arguments here, and we wanted to clarify that aspect, why we might have some delays in phase for some quantities. Now, I need this space, so allow me to delete this one for a moment, to take it away. And now, you are very good at solving this type of problem. We did this. You are also very good at dealing with these types of problems where you have lossless medium. Now, we're going to see a new domain or a new regime where the material is lossy, there is a conductivity, but we have two specific domains where sigma is much smaller than one and sigma is much higher than one, okay? So this is conductive but low conductivity. This is conductive, but it's a very good conductor. Okay? Once we are dealing with a very good conductor, we need to do some approximations in the propagation constants. Okay, so some parameters which will come out from the wave equation have to be adjusted accordingly. And whenever we see these, okay, these considerations, you should always remember what type of approximations did we use to do in special cases. Okay, so just go back to, for example, what are some common approximations? Let's think for a moment. We have 1 plus epsilon to the power, actually this epsilon, I'm afraid you might confuse this one with the permittivity, but let's write this one, I would say this one, because this is also like a delta, but now this is called, this, we're going to consider this one a, let's write, we are going to consider this one as skin depth, but let's assume that x is much smaller than 1. What is this approximation? This is approximately 1 plus nx, okay? So please go back to some notes that you might have from calculus or any, you open an old textbook and see how you're going to apply these approximations, okay? So in this case, this is what goes on with this, but the moment that x is much larger than 1, if you have 1 plus x to the power n, and if x is much larger than 1, what happens here is that this one is neglected. So we are going to have something like x to the power n. Okay, so we have this here, and we have this other case here. So we are at this point here. Now the issue is that what are the major aspects that you should never forget? We have to figure out, first of all, how we can derive these, okay? So how can we derive such a relationship between... So how can we get anything out? It is good to know at least once how this can be derived, and then once you do this one just once, I guess it's enough, okay? You do not need to derive this each time, but it's good to go over the textbook and do it step by step, because it gives you the intuition and also the understanding which you should have it. But when it comes to the issue of being able to be in an exam, so you can always write these formulas in a formula sheet, because memorizing those would be a beautiful challenge. But now everything, it starts from determining. It starts from the wave equation, and the wave equation, it's always defined as okay, so this is how the wave equation of the electric field, how this one is defined, and let me have a look here. So we could
We could derive all of it, or wait a second. So in this wave equation, we just have a function which will appear in one. I'm wondering whether we should so actually let's continue from where we left here. So we said that we're going to have this sigma which is different from zero, and the moment that the sigma is different from zero, we're going to have a column which is going to be equal to sigma times e. Okay, so this is the new term which is going to appear in the Maxwell's equation. So now the moment that we have this new term, which it used to be zero in these two cases, so let's consider this one, this is case one, this is case two, and mostly mediums, this is case three. In the first two cases, this was zero, and then we had no energy dissipation. But the moment that this is different from zero, we have energy dissipation or energy loss, okay? We have energy dissipation slash energy loss. And the moment we have the energy loss, this will be reflected in the amplitude of the electric field, which means that after some distance, the energy will be lost and the amplitude of the wave will be smaller. It might even diminish to and converge to zero. So because of this, we can determine, or we can conclude, that this permittivity is going to be E0 plus the square root of minus 1 times E1, okay? So even this coefficient here, this epsilon 0 or this epsilon r, which were just real numbers, now they can appear as complex numbers or as complex quantities. And then the equations of motion will be as follows. So we have that the curl of h, this is equal to the curl density plus this term. So when we did this last week, this was zero, but now we're going to insert this term here, and this would be, this j is going to be sigma e plus d is equal to, let's not forget, the displacement vector, this is EE, so it's a permittivity times the electric field. And also, let's not forget that when we are dealing with this term, d over dt, this is equal to what? If we are dealing with the phasor notation, what is the time derivative? This is going to be minus j omega. Okay, the same way that when we take the derivative with respect to z, you know what this is. This is going to be kz. Or so, and then let's look for a moment. Here we're going to have the derivative with respect to time. We're going to have here j omega. D is going to have also the permittivity times e. So we see that this curve.
Sorry.
Yes.
And would it minus j omega epsilon e?
Here, yes, we can, that's true. But yes, this is what it's going to be. And then with the sigma, we can factor out, factor out the e, and we can really notice that effectively the response of a material against an external electric field, which is this one here, it would be a complex, it's going to have some complex terms, okay? And with these complex terms, we can say that the general expression, which is traditionally written like this, E is equal to E0 to the power minus
J gamma z. Okay. Now this gamma is a propagation factor, and here we're going to have e zero times e to the power minus j. Now these approximations, I think we can take this away because you can you already know those. Okay. Just have a look at. You need to remind yourself how these approximations are done so that you understand the derivation. So this propagation constant now is going to be alpha plus j beta, okay, times z. And then you look at this a little more in details, and you get a term which might come something like e to the power beta z times e to the power minus j alpha z, okay? So once you look at these expressions, you notice that you have an exponentially changing function, and you have also an oscillatory function. Now, this oscillatory function, it will, it's going to be there, but then this term here, this will represent the amplitude. Okay, so the amplitude of often material against an external excitation is going to change with this amplitude, oscillating with this frequency. And now we see that we need to know. What is essential for us is to derive these two parameters, which we are going to call this alpha and beta. Now, both of these two constants, they have one of them. We are going to see how we define those. But for this, let's get some. Okay, so let's assume E y is that so this is the wave equation. Of course, this is a vector, and we know that since all the three components of the vector, which is E x, E y, and E z, they are orthogonal with respect to each other. They are independent. So we can solve any one of these equations. Okay, so we can solve here, we are provided with three different equations, but we can pick only one, and we can simply state the following, minus gamma squared Ex, this is equal to zero. Okay, so we can select just one of those, and then the solution for this, let's think for a moment, this is Ex, okay, and let's assume that the Ex is the component along the x direction, but let it be as a function of z. Now, what do we mean with this one? If you remember, the last time we had a class together, we said that the electric field, it can have an expression like this. Let's say that this is E0, the amplitude, times Ax, times e to the power minus j beta z. Now, this z here, this just means that the wave is propagating along the z axis. Okay, so please, let's try to be to pick this up, this important information, because from the exercises we saw the last week, or the last sessions, we were noticing that the electric field, let's try this, actually, we have also another term e to the power minus j omega t, right? And this depends, this e is a function of z and t. E is not a function of x, at all, okay, because it does not change as you are going along the x-axis. So for a moment, imagine that let's see for a moment. So let's say that we have a plane wave, and a plane wave is moving in the z direction. So I have a piece of paper here. So as we are moving in the z direction, the magnitude of the electric field is going to be like this pen here. So it's going to point in this direction, it's going to decrease in amplitude and come down. But this is the x-axis, which is pointing in this direction. The propagation is this way. Now, the E is going to change as a function of where it's going to be in space, but not whether it's here or here, okay? Because if this is the x-axis, the different photons will have a representative electric field, which is going to be equal along this axis, and also along this axis. So if the antenna of our cell phone company is far away, and we put our cell phone right here, that means that if we move it, let's assume that the wave is coming in this direction. So this is my cell phone, okay? I'm holding it like this, here I have it. And then, this is my cell phone, I want to say that the electric field I measure here, assume the wave is coming this way, the electric field here, and also at the bottom of my cell phone is all the same. It does not depend on the x and the y, it only depends along the z, if I move it in this axis, okay? And that's why we call this one a plane wave. A plane wave is a wave where all the electric fields in the surface area of my cell phone, they have the same phase, okay, continuity and phase, okay, which means that electric field vector strength is not going to decrease across the screen or across the pixels of our cell phone, okay. So with this discussion, I just really want to remind us that this electric field, which is important, if it is if the direction of the electric field is along x or y, if it's propagated along the z, this is where it depends on. Okay? So with this one, we just want to say that we are picking up this equation, and we should also not forget that this del square operator, then square operator. What is this equal to? What is a del square? Del square is going to be this term, which is equal to the second derivative with respect to x. Okay? We remember this from the previous class we together, plus the second derivative with respect to y, plus the second derivative with respect to z. Okay? But now, since this electric field depends only on z, this means that this will cancel out, this will cancel out, and in principle, we will be left as with the following term. So this whole thing, this will be the second derivative of Ex with respect to Z minus gamma squared Ex, this is equal to zero. Okay, so far, we don't have much new piece of information, but we come down to this point, and then the solution of the second order differential equation is going to look like this. We have the Ex as a function of z. This is going to be equal to a constant c1 e to the power minus gamma z plus another constant c2 e to the power plus gamma z. Okay? So both of these are solutions of this equation. For example, we can make up, let's assume for a moment, let's say that e is equal to e to the power, give me one gamma. Can somebody tell me a number? You can say e to the power 2z, for example, okay? So you substitute e to the power 2z, you take the derivative twice, you put it in this equation, and it should be a solution of this equation. Because, let's think for a moment, so what is the solution here? This is a second order differential equation, and the solution, you can search, for example, if cosine 2x is a solution here. So if this is equal to y, minus 2 sine 2x is going to be the first derivative of y, and then minus 4 cosine 2x is going to be the second derivative of y. Okay? Then what you can do, sorry, this is the second derivative. So this means that minus 4 cosine 2x plus 4 cosine 2x is going to be equal to 0. So we confirmed it. Okay? So you can check this simple differential equation, and it looks like this is going to be a solution. And if cosine and sine are solutions, also exponentials, exponential terms are solutions of these types of differential equations. So we have these terms here, but then we assume that this gamma unknown, because the response can simply, we are convinced that the response can be a complex number. So this gamma can also be written as c1 e to the power minus alpha z e to the power minus j beta z plus c2 is another constant e to the power alpha z times e to the power j beta z. Okay? So how did we conclude this? This is a differential equation. The solution of any differential equation that looks like this is this. To convince ourselves, we can have a look at these types of equations of how the solution should look like, and that's what we get. Now, here we have, I think this is something just for to illustrate something, so can you erase this part too? So now, when we have, let's assume for a moment, let me ask you this one. Imagine for a moment, but I want an answer from here, I'm going to pick alphabetically, whoever is going to be here, Andy Gini. Okay, Andy, try to follow me here. Expect for a moment, Andy, if alpha is larger than zero, okay? If alpha is larger than zero, and the wave is propagating in the plus z direction. Let's assume that z is equal to 1. what would you expect here for this component of the wave when alpha is larger than 0 and z is equal to 1? What is the answer, Andy? Andy, can you answer this?
We saw for nuclear do it.
Sure, there's such a error. It's C2 times e to the power alpha. Let's put alpha on.
Alpha.
Let's put alpha 2. So this is going to be e to e squared, right?
Power 2, yes.
That's good, okay. Now, let's assume that the waves are traveling from where the antenna is. It's going, I don't know, you have an antenna in Tirana, you pick the signal in Duros. It is possible, right? It
would be, yes.
That's good. So let's assume again, alpha is equal to 2. And z expressed in meters, it can be 40 kilometers. You go to Duros, 40 times 1000, it makes it 40,000 meters. Okay, it's doable. We can transmit signals from Tirana to Duros. And then here, the answer here is going to be C2, which is a constant, times e to the power, 2 times 40,000.
80,000.
80,000. Okay, so what do you think about this number? What is this number? As engineers, this is, Andy, do you have any comment? What is this number? Huh?
Distanza signore dopo se parlare.
Yes, that's correct. But as an engineer that you'll be pretty soon, this number
is this a frequency it needs to be or no?
Infinite.
You just rotate this 80 here and we can make up an infinity. Okay? This is infinity. Anything exponential to the power of 80,000, it is crazy. Okay? It's a very high signal. So imagine now you have an antenna in Tirana and you're sending a signal to Duros and the signal is stronger. So I mean you wish you had the chance. It never happens. Okay. So what do we understand from here?
First of all, Paul, një pyetje kam kur
Unë nuk e llogarisim dot të që themi është infinit, atëherë si shkon sinjali?
Atëherë, e para është këtu ka një konflikt, this is a huge conflict, okay, so we don't put in practical terms, it's impossible to get an exponentially increasing signals, okay? And this does not happen, at least yet. And I don't think it will ever be possible. But with this aspect now, I believe that it is clear that this wave, when alpha is larger than 2, this can never propagate along the positive z direction. Okay? So this it propagates only along the minus z direction. So this part of the solution, this allows only z to be minus 40,000. We are comfortable with that. Okay? Because e to the power minus 80,000, it converges to 0. I think we believe that it's much more easier for us to expect a solution which converges to zero rather than blowing up to infinity. Okay, and exponential terms, we are scared of exponential terms because we're not scared that much when they converge to zero, right? You put a minus sign, everybody's comfortable. Okay, but this is unacceptable. Okay, you can never increase to infinity a signal with an antenna in Dighton. And you send it to Fundurus, and it would be perfect. But no, this means that this solution is only valid when the wave is propagating along the minus z direction. And this solution, this is a wave which propagates along the plus z direction. So during the semester, you are often going to see solutions that look like this, and you have to pick up the correct solution just by trying to make sense of when the things are going out of proportion or when the things make sense at all, okay? So I believe now it's clear that this wave is a propagation along the minus z axis and this is along the propagation along the plus z axis and we call this term, this is Ex along the plus z, okay? And this, we call this one as Ex that travels along the minus x, minus z direction, okay? So here we have these expressions. Now I'm going to need this part of the board. So this electric field that we see here, we can write this one as the what do we call an expression? So here we just show the z dependence, okay? But we want to write also the time dependence. And when we enter the time dependence, we call this one instantaneous expression, okay? Instantaneous expression, we call this one because we want to see also the time, time dependence. And in that case, we would have that this e, which depends on z and time, this will be c1 e to the power minus alpha z times cosine of omega t minus beta z plus c2 e to the power alpha z cosine omega t plus beta z. Okay, so this will be the instantaneous solution for this differential equation. Now, here we are going to have these two, and we can see that this term, the alpha, so let's not forget now, this gamma is now alpha plus jb, and alpha, we call this one attenuation constant, okay? Attenuation constant, that's the only thing it can be. It cannot amplify. We cannot call this one the amplification constant. This is the attenuation constant, and the question is, what is the unit of this alpha? Do we have any comment on this one? What would be the unit of alpha? First of all, it's going to be anything over meter, because the exponential, this term should have no units, this alpha z. Z is measured in meters, so this alpha should be 1 over meters. But because of the attenuation, we call this number NP over meter. And then we have also the beta, which now, beta, it's called the phase constant. So this beta is radian per meter. Okay, so these units, never forget those. And we call this one radian because it is inside the cosine. So the total unit of this is radian, it's an angle. And beta z should be radian, so that means that z is meters, beta is 1 over meters. So here we have these two. We have these two important components, and we can now so this is the propagation constant, and then from here we can derive the alpha, which is going to be omega permeability times permittivity over 2 multiplied with 1 plus sigma over this term. This is the attenuation constant, and the beta, which is the other component, is going to be omega times the same term remains as it was before. But now, instead of having, sorry, and here we have also another huge square root. This is also 1 over 2. Maybe this doesn't look, it looks okay. But now here, it's going to be, we have a square root here, 1 plus sigma over this term plus 1 to the power 1 over 2 radian per meter. So this is the phase. So for any medium, this is what we are going to search for, okay? Or we will identify these numbers. Now the derivation of these three equations, we are going to show this one very soon. But for the moment, let's have a look, and these can constitute important relations, which you can write these in the formula sheet, okay? Just that for the, we are saying this one just for the sake that you don't need to memorize these. But then, one thing that we can notice is the following. For example, if we have a material, so first of all, the moment we see the sigma, this means that we have a conductivity which is different from zero. Okay, that's the first one. But then, let's consider the first case when sigma is much smaller than 1. What will happen if sigma is much smaller than 1? So, sigma much smaller than 1, this means that sigma can be 10 to the power minus 4. Okay? We have the capability to measure such low conductivity values. Okay? And then we look at this expression here for alpha, and what happens then? We have sigma to something like 10 to the power minus 4. What would be the square? This means that the sigma square, actually, when you say sigma square, just for a moment, assume that sigma over omega times permittivity is a very small number, okay? Because you might say that, oh, but professor, that the omega is, it can be also small or large, whatever. But assume now that this whole term is very small, it's too small. Then this sigma square is going to be 10 to the power minus 8, right? Okay. So if this is 10 to the power minus 8 plus 1, what is it? Plus 1, this means that this would be still, it's going to be something like 1 plus a very small number, 1 plus x squared, okay, and then this whole thing is to the square root, so this is 1 over 2. But what did we say before? We said that when this x squared is too very small, this will be equal to 1 plus 1 over 2 x squared. Okay, remember this, what did we say before? We said 1 plus x to the power n. When x is too small, this was 1 plus nx. Okay, so this whole term, it comes to, it's approximately this value. Then we have here minus 1. I'm writing actually, so this part, we take 1 minus 1, this is gone. This is also square root. So this whole thing is square root. So finally, we get 1 over square root of 2 times x. Okay? So let's not forget what x was. X was actually this term here, sigma. So you can do this math again, and most probably, using this approximation, when sigma is much smaller than 1, we're going to get omega stays here, permeability times permittivity divided by 2. We get this term, and again, if I don't miss anything here, so again, this was 1 plus x squared, 1 plus x squared to the power 1 over 2, we get this, minus 1, we get this, then we get here 1 over square root of 2 times x, where x is sigma omega permittivity. So we have here sigma, sorry, this is sigma divided by omega permittivity. Okay, so this is what we are going to expect. And then let's have a look again. I think this sigma omega permittivity, this omega might cancel this omega. So we get something like sigma stays here times divided by 2 permittivity. Then we have permeability over permittivity. Okay, so we get such a term. Okay, so this whole expression, it can be simplified to this if the material is conductive, but it's negligibly conductive, it's very small. So this is one one of the approximations maybe we can erase this for the sake of the space. So what is going to be beta then here? Beta is going to be something like, let's see, this will be too small, this is going to be 1 plus x squared to the power 1 over 2 is going to be 1 plus x squared over 2. We have plus 1, so this becomes 2. Then 2 plus a very small number, it's 2 plus, actually this is almost 2. So 2 to the power 1 over 2, we get square root of 2 for the beta. So if we multiply with square root of 2, it will cancel out this. So beta is going to be omega mu here, okay? So this answer here and this answer here, they correspond to this condition. Then we can have another special condition where sigma is different from zero, but the sigma, actually maybe let's do the correct way, and most of you might it's better if we do it like this, which means that if we have a very good conductor, so not only what is a small conductivity material? It can be salty water, okay? You get some water in the kitchen, you throw a little bit of salt, it makes it conductive, okay? So you can measure electrolysis, or you can do electrochemistry measurements. You put a couple of electrodes, you can detect the potential difference very easily. Okay. Or sometimes you might see these videos on YouTube, or maybe if you are a good student in high school, you might have put these electrodes in a lemon or in an orange, and it's easy to pick up a conductive medium with liquids that have some salts or some bases or some acids. Okay, good. So we said this is a very good conductor because conductivity is much higher than this term. And then what will happen with this term here? So if this is huge, that means that this is huge, plus one will be disregarded, and then because it's something like 10 to the power 8, plus 1, what is it? This is still 10 to the power 8. Okay, so you just throw out the 1. So this is going to be 10 to the power 8 square root is going to be 10 to the power 8 minus 1. It will still be the same thing. Then as a result, this will be omega permeability times permittivity over square root of 2 times, this term stays the same, sigma over omega this. And finally, the second option here, I'm going to write this one as, let's put here approximately, and this is approximately, and this term, omega will cancel the omega, it's going to be sigma times, can help me here, this is going to be square root of permittivity divided by, no, permeability over permittivity. And I think the two survives, the two term survives. So this one, when sigma is much higher than one, this sigma is much smaller than one. Okay. Now similarly, again, the sigma is much smaller than one, so you can see the general expressions are these, but you're going to conclude either to this or to this. And then similarly, I think this would be a huge number, square, plus one, neglected, square root, it would cancel out the plus one, again, gone. Wait a second. No. Okay, we made a mistake, because this was square, this is square root, it will remain the same term, it's going to be square root of this actually, sorry. Okay, so this is row. Let's do a better job for a moment. This is omega times the mu permittivity divided by 2 times, overall, we're going to have the square root of this term. This is going to be square root sigma permittivity divided by square root of omega permittivity. Okay, I think this looks better. Okay, then this omega will be here. I guess we'll have a square root. Omega stays here and they cancel out. This cancels out this term. We have this, we have sigma divided by 2. Okay, this looks better. We have to fix this in time before it's too late. If I do any similar mistake, please correct me. And then similarly, we get here that the beta is going to be equal to, let's write what beta is going to be. This is going to be mu permittivity divided by 2, this is square root, times the square root of sigma omega here. And it looks like for a very good conductor, these expressions look like they're going to be the same. Yes, it's going to be the same. So this is going to be omega permeability conductivity divided by 2. So again, I wish I had a different color pen, so I should have it here. So this was, if we are dealing with a very good conductor, sigma, okay, cold has an effect on this, okay. The sigma is much higher than 1. So we notice that for very good conductors, actually, I can erase these approximations because I think they are clear to us now. But it looks like when if you're dealing with very good conductors, this was also just for illustrative purposes. So let me check again. I think this term here and this term here, they correspond to this. Okay, we can read it like this, and from here we read it like this. Okay, and this was for weak conductors. Conductivity. And for very good conductors, we simply have that the alpha, sorry, this is sigma, this is alpha I cannot write alpha is equal to beta is equal to omega mu sigma 2. So they are equal, okay? So if they are equal, if we have a look at this, so we have, but the amplitudes are the same, but the propagation constant, so this constant here, this means that the gamma is equal to alpha plus j beta. So, and then this number, this is something like, imagine for a moment, this is going to be something like 2 plus 2j, okay? So what does this represent when we're talking about the complex number space? We have, this is 2, and 2j is here. And what is this in the complex domain? This is an amplitude here with a phase angle phi, which is going to be equal to pi over 4, okay? Or 45 degrees. So that means that the phase angle for the propagation constant for good conductors, it's simply 45 degrees, okay? So let's keep this somewhere, remember this specific value. But more or less, this is what happens when we have conductive regions. And something else that we can add is also the fact that, actually, we wrote this one in the previous hour, but maybe I can write this again. So when we have conductivity, this is an important relationship. So we have the effective permittivity is equal to the normal permittivity minus J sigma over omega. Okay, so let's have a look at this term. And so I guess now this is clear, just to make up for this complex number representation. Another important factor is the impedance. The impedance now, so let's not forget, what was the impedance? Impedance, it was the ratio of the magnitude of the electric field to the magnitude of the magnetic field. So let's not forget that they are 90 degrees off phase with respect to each other, electric field magnitude divided by the magnetic field magnitude. And now this is called the impedance. We write it with a C because it's a complex value. And this is going to be equal to the amplitude of C times e to the power j phi beta. Okay? So now this eta is going to be 45 degrees as we said before. But the complete expression is going to be the following. So this is equal to mu over E effective. Actually, this definition is still stays the same. Let's not forget that in vacuum, this was equal to mu zero over epsilon zero, right? This was 120 pi, or it's around 377. Okay? We had this expression before. We already know this one very well. Now, this is exactly the same, only that now this is going to be a complex number, as reported. And this is equal to the square root of mu over permittivity minus j sigma over omega. And then we can play around with this one to get a correct expression. We can divide everywhere with the we can divide mu divided by permittivity, this is square root 1 minus j sigma over omega Okay, so we divided the permittivity everywhere, and wait a second, somehow we can move across this one. And we can also add the following. The division by complex number, this is not defined. So I think it's something like this, 2 divided by 3 plus 4i. This is equal to 2 divided by 3 plus 4i times 3 minus 4i, okay, times 3 minus 4i. Because we simply cannot divide by complex number. The same way that we cannot divide by a matrix. The division by a matrix with another matrix is not defined. Similarly, we do this. Now, the same technique we do here, so this is going to be something like this. What is this? This is 5. So here we get the magnitude of this times 6 minus 8i. Okay? This is just to remind you of how we deal with the division of complex numbers, which means that this number here, we just need to multiply with 1 plus j sigma omega over permittivity, 1 plus j sigma over frequency permittivity, okay? Now this is a better looking expression for reasons that we just clarified, and then this is going to be equal to 1 plus now 1 minus j squared, but we know that j squared is minus 1 plus another minus, this becomes 1 plus, this is going to be 1 plus j squared is gone, 1 plus sigma squared over omega squared permittivity squared. So we have this expression, and then this will come up, but finally we're going to have something like this, and here we get 1 plus sigma over omega permittivity all squared, and this is going to be to the power 1 over 4, and then we have this e to the power, we have the j, so it's the phase now. Now, what is the phase here? Let's look for a moment. In order to find out what is the phase here, we have to look at the here. So the angle is going to be equal to, so the real part is 1, okay? So let's draw here the, so the real part is 1, and the complex part, it is sigma over omega, actually it's down here because it's a minus sign, but let's do it for a plus for a moment. This is sigma over omega times permittivity. And how do we find this angle? So when we had a very good conductor, we said that this angle was going to be 45 because they were equal. The real part and the complex part, the amplitudes. And here, how do we find this angle? This angle is equal to the tangent. What is the tangent? Tangent of this angle, tangent phi, is going to be equal to the length of y, which is equal to this term actually. So this one over 1. So this tangent phi is sigma over frequency times the permittivity. So apparently we found what this angle is. And again, as a we can do another example, but I think this is, we don't need to do all of it. So finally we get here 1 over 2 tangent inverse arctangent of sigma over this term. Okay, so now this looks a little complex term, but at least we understand how we derive it and how we get it. Now, if you like, you can. Do we have any question for so far? And let me see if we have any comments here. Okay, we don't have much comments from you. If you prefer, we can have a short break. We'll meet in 5 to 10 minutes.
Professor,
Pop.
Do Nitro Sector recording?
Pop, pa tjetër, po. In fact, leksionet